And now, ABC's 2020.
Tonight, remembering a woman who could turn the world on with her smile.
The show is brilliant because Mary is who you want to be.
A TV icon speaking out.
Will you shut up, Ted?
And inspiring generations of young girls and women.
Oh, my God, I wanted to be mayor.
Co-stars what you life? Love.
And I look around at these girls and I just...
Me too.
My heart fills up with so...
How the show almost ended before it ever got started.
It tested and still retains this honor as being the lowest ranked television episode ever viewed.
And our revealing visits with Mary through the years.
They say, she is so nice.
The secrets no one knew.
People were stunned when it came out that I went to Betty Ford.
The struggle with diabetes behind that gladiator smile.
You wake up and you say, is this going to be the day?
Did you ever think this is insupportable?
I can't stand it. I really can't.
And the life-changing part in ordinary people that finally tapped her dark side.
And then you come to me and tell me how to be happy.
I mean, the whole movie is about the loss of a child, the loss of a son. And then that happened.
Very reminiscent of my own life.
Now we celebrate and say goodbye.
Thank you for my family.
Hats off in Minneapolis today for the legend who made it. After all.
Good evening, everyone. I'm David Muir.
And I'm Elizabeth Vargas. She was the woman millions of people welcomed into their homes every Saturday night and into their hearts forever. Mary Tyler Moore, who died this week at the age of 80 of heart problems related to pneumonia. For so many of us, she changed our futures, one laugh line at a time.
But behind those laughs, she also hid great pain and, as we now know, personal heartbreak. So tonight, a special tribute to Mary Tyler Moore. Stories from her friends right here, also your favorite episodes, and the surprising thing she said was her greatest regret, which had nothing to do with showbiz.
Mary Tyler Moore.
Mary Tyler Moore dazzled us with her dancing,
3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8.
Made us keel over in laughter.
I usually look so much better than
Mary and Tyler like Moore. The song says, turned the whole world on with her smile.
Mary Tyler Moore was without question one of the most influential actresses in television history. All you needed to say was one word, Mary. Everybody knew what you were talking about.
She ripped up the television comedy rule book and rewrote the chapter on women.
I'm obsessed, and you're just ignoring it.
Well, I figured it was just one of those woman things.
Mr. Brad, it's not.
She was actually one of the first to portray a modern woman on television.
She reaches right out through the television set, says, yeah, I gotcha.
I think Mary Tyler Moore probably had more influence on my career than any other single person or force.
She was the first character to make people laugh by being good at her job. Lucille Ball made us laugh by being bad when she was trying to work.
Speed it up!
Mary Richards made you laugh by handling the egos and the insecurities of all the guys she worked with.
Read it. All right.
Out loud!
But to understand just how Mary was able to make it after all, you have to rewind to Brooklyn in the 1930s, where right from the start, Mary set herself apart from the rest.
And I was born in Brooklyn, and when you're from Brooklyn, you're supposed to talk like you're from Brooklyn, right? Yeah. You know what I mean? Well, my family had no money, but they did both major in English in college, and they taught me how to speak correctly.
Her early life is a difficult one, with an alcoholic mother and a distant father. For solace, young Mary turns to dancing, working hard at limbering up the legs that would one day carry her to Hollywood.
My grandfather once said of me, having watched me prancing and leaping, "This child will either end up on stage or in jail."
When her family decides to go west, moving to California, 9-year-old Mary is the first one out the door.
I knew I would be discovered in Hollywood. I mean, it wasn't likely to happen in Brooklyn.
At 18, in an act of rebellion, Mary marries her first husband, a salesman nearly 10 years her senior. She would later explain why to Barbara Walters.
Why did you get married so young?
Well, you know, I don't want to denigrate my parents, but I was going through a stage at about 16, 17, 18, where I didn't like them very much, and I really wanted to be independent. I didn't want to be told what to do.
Every day.
In 1955, Mary breaks into show business. As a dancing pixie, but Hot Point Appliances goes cold on Mary after she gets pregnant.
There I was, not looking very much like the logo they had in mind.
After the birth of son Richie, she turns to acting. And though it may have started slow with bit roles on television, she told our Diane Sawyer in 1993 it was her only option.
You really think that you would have gone in some completely different trajectory?
If I hadn't
dancing
become an actress,
or...
I think I probably would have been homeless. I really don't think there's very much else in life I was prepared to do. But I was disciplined.
That discipline would carry Mary to her big break. In 1961, she is called into audition for the Dick Van Dyke Show. Legendary comedian Carl Reiner was the show's creator.
And she said the first line, and I heard this sound in a voice, a ping in a voice. My hand became the claw in that machine that picks out candy in the at the arcades. I walked across the room.
In the middle of the scene, he put his hand on my head, sitting in a chair across from him, and said, "Get up." I got up, and he steered me down the hall to Sheldon Leonard's office.
And I said, "Sheldon, I got it."
The Dick Van Dyke Show.
But her on-screen husband, Dick Van Dyke, isn't as sure.
She was 23 when she came on the show and had never done any comedy.
I knew I was in with a bunch of black belts in comedy, and I had no real experience at it.
Even if Mary herself was a little unsure, America wasn't. It fell in love with her portrayal of the feisty and funny housewife, Laura Petrie.
Are you angry with me for something?
What makes you think that?
She just got it so quickly that I'm still fascinated by how fast she grew on that show.
But as her career takes off, Mary's personal life stumbles when her first marriage fails. She turns to Carl Reiner for support.
I was her father figure because her father was a non-communicative man who didn't know how to talk to her. She was 16 years old before he ever gave her a compliment, and she was going to a prom with a prom dress, and he looked at her and he says, "Mary, you look very handsome." That was the only compliment they ever got. Imagine a beauty like that, getting that as your only compliment.
On the show, Reiner encourages Mary to bring parts of herself to the role.
The big objection was the pants that I wore. I had seen too many housewives on television who were vacuuming in high heels and a floral printed frock. And I said, "Wait a minute, that's not the way it really is." I wanted to represent something of me, and I was married and a mother and wore pants.
Oh, Rob.
And that familiar line would become her catchphrase.
Oh, Rob. Oh, Rob. Oh, Rob.
Just two words that could say so much.
People were saying that, even if their husbands weren't Rob.
Oh, Rob.
I look great here.
As her confidence grows, Mary found both popular success and critical acclaim.
The winner in Hollywood is Mary Tyler Moore.
Winning her first two Emmy Awards for the show. But far more gratifying for her personally was the respect of one particular peer.
Gee, I'm glad you're home. How's about a great big...
I'll see you later.
Lucille Ball was our landlady at that point. She owned Desi Lu, and we'd be rehearsing on the set, and then we'd hear a laugh. We looked up, and there she was on the catwalk, and she'd be up there watching us. And I will never forget one day she sort of walked out of the studio and then came back and came up to me, and she said, "You're very good," and then walked on. And that was the greatest gift I ever received in this business.
The Dick Van Dyke Show ran for five seasons before going off the air in 1966.
It was the end of a family, the family that I never felt comfortable with as a child. I suddenly felt at home with this bunch of people.
And by now, Mary had married a second time to an advertising executive named Grant Tinker. Together, the couple was about to transform the TV landscape.
What nobody saw coming was she would be front and center on one of the most formative shows in television history. This was a seismic change.
Stay with us. When the cameras stop rolling on The Dick Van Dyke Show, Mary Tyler Moore takes a gamble, makes a break for Broadway, and accepts what seems to be the perfect role.
Wherever you're going.
Audrey Hepburn's Holly Golightly in a staged adaptation of the classic film Breakfast at Tiffany's. That's Mary, alongside her young and sprightly leading man, Richard Chamberlain.
That was your one venture into Broadway, and it seemed to have everything.
It sure did.
And it was the super-duper flop.
Super-duper.
As Mary's dreams on the Great White Way quickly fade, the resilient actress decides to take her dance steps to the silver screen.
I must study you if I'm going to be an actress. You see, the theater today is full of ruthless women.
She did have a pretty nice role in Thoroughly Modern Millie, which was opposite Julie Andrews.
It showcased her wonderful skills.
But just as the young ingenue is about to regain her stride, her next role opposite Elvis Presley has the actress reciting a whole lot of Hail Marys.
I'm a member of the Order of Little Sisters of Mary.
She did play a nun. Hence the Change of Habit title.
The film Change of Habit hits far from gold at the box office. It would turn out to be the King's last dramatic role in a movie and Mary's last appearance on the silver screen for more than a decade.
Mary Tyler Moore's career kind of bumped around here and there for a while aimlessly.
Then, the woman who dazzled the world as Laura Petri is asked to reunite with her former co-star in a television variety special called Dick Van Dyke and the Other Woman.
We showcased her. She danced. We did sketches.
Remember when I said I'd like you to come on my special?
Mm-hmm.
And you said, how long was it? And I said, an hour?
Yeah.
What's up?
The show is a ratings getter. The network brass quickly offer Mary her own sitcom bearing her name. Her partner in the project, Grant Tinker. The husband and wife team collaborate on a comedy about a decidedly single woman by the name of Mary Richards.
Mary Richards was actually originally intended to be a divorced woman, and CBS hated this idea. They said people don't want to see divorced people on television any more than they want to see people with mustaches, Jews, or people from New York.
Mary's character is eventually retooled on Saturday, September 19th, 1970.
What do you think?
As a nation is embroiled in anti-war protests, the Mary Tyler Moore Show debuts on Tiffany Network.
So you're Rhoda Morgenstern, and I'm Mary Ritz.
The Mary Tyler Moore Show came on television when I was just 12 or 13 years old.
Who can turn the world on with her smile?
The opening sequence of that show, you had sort of the fear and trepidation of driving to a new city and seeing a job with people you didn't know. And it made me think, hey, I could do that. I could have a career.
CBS First fears a show about a single woman juggling home and work, a woman who drives the quintessential muscle car, a Ford Mustang, will fail to attract an audience. They wonder if the sitcom will resonate with stereotypical stay-at-home American housewife.
This show was not an instant hit at all.
What nobody saw coming was that she would be front and center on one of the most formative shows in television history, a show that would not only reshape the way women were portrayed in television.
I represent women everywhere.
Well, Mary, that's all in your head.
Oh, yeah? What'd you say if the station manager kept trotting in group people and saying, this is our woman executive?
But would shape the way viewers thought of themselves and thought about women in the workplace.
An associate producer employed in the fictitious newsroom WJM, the character of Mary Richards has her share of run-ins with her rough-and-tumble boss, Lou Grant.
There was one scene when Mary went to Mr. Grant and said,
I would like to know why the last associate producer before me made $50 a week more than I do.
And Lou Grant looked up at her and said,
because he was a man.
I mean, they were dealing with pay equity before anyone even understood the term.
As the show builds a budding audience, the Mary Tyler Moore Show also begins knocking down taboos on television.
You too, Mom.
Like birth control.
Don't forget to take your pip. I won't.
That was really unheard of in the early 70s, but so funny. And as Lou Grant said,
you know what? You got spunk.
Oh, yes.
I had spunk.
One of my favorite moments was when she told Ted Baxter,
"Will you shut up, Ted?"
Every woman who had to deal with egotistic, bombastic, conceited coworker, they were giving her a standing ovation at that moment.
But as forward-thinking as the show is for its day, feminists like Gloria Steinem aren't fawning over the show, or for that matter, the new fresh face of feminism.
Next to something like MASH, or next to something like All in the Family, or Good Times, or The Jeffersons, or any number of these shows, it might have looked like it was avoiding the issues on everybody's mind in the early 1970s.
Feminists really picked her apart a little bit. They wanted her to be the perfect feminist, and she wasn't.
Thanks, Mr. Grant.
She, her boss, Mr. Grant, when everyone else around called him Lou.
As the book Mary and Lou and Rhoda and Ted points out, the sitcom is quietly breaking ground in another way, behind the scenes.
They also hired more women writers than any other show before it.
Female writers who know a thing or two about sex and the single girl.
What do you think you're doing?
Oh, I just figured it would be.
Put on your shirt.
Come on, Mary.
What? On your shirt!
You value that writing. You never take it for granted, because it doesn't happen that often.
Hello?
What they could never imagine is that they were about to pave the way for future aspiring comedy writers like Lena Dunham, Amy Schumer, and Tina Fey.
If you call yours, I'll call mine.
Because before anyone ever heard of Carrie, Miranda, Samantha, and Charlotte, there was Mary, Phyllis, Sue Ann, and Rhoda.
The show is brilliant because Mary is who you want to be, who you wish you were. Rhoda is who you probably are. And Phyllis is who you're afraid you'll become. And that's pretty close to the truth.
Because if you push me, then I just might have to push back. Hard. Come on, you can't carry that off. I know.
But the Mary Tyler Moore Show did push back.
She went out on a date and stayed out all night.
Challenging the premise, who says you can be single and alone, but not lonely?
You looked at it and you thought, well, who needs a boyfriend? I mean, great if it happens, but who needs a guy to orient your life around?
Take care of yourself?
Mary was kicking ass on her.
I think I just did.
Next, how Mary and a clown named Chuckles made TV history.
A little song, a little dance,
a little self-study.
Comedy gold.
When we return.
Do you have any idea of when I started working
there? Oh, I guess a year ago.
Mm-hmm. It was a year ago last week.
Season 2, Against the Odds, America embraces a complex, strong, modern working woman, and Mary Tyler Moore begins to shine.
How many big disasters do we have here in Minneapolis?
Hi, guys.
Nice timing, Ted.
Mary's gifts are bolstered by a surrounding cast that brims with talent and a mixed bag of personalities dancing together as one on screen.
They had, you know, a phenomenal cast of characters.
Maury McIntyre is the president of the Television Academy, which interviewed the entire cast of The Mary Tyler Moore Show for its online archive.
Lou Grant, who was so gruff and hearty.
The only time I push people away is when I don't want them around me.
Murray Slaughter.
I'm going to see how long it takes before you say something stupid.
Is that an insult?
3 seconds.
Ted Baxter was always so into himself.
We'll see who's the funny guy out here.
We're on the air, Ted.
I know that.
That vessel of uncorked ambition, Sue Ann Nivens.
I must confess, it baffles me why Lou would want something he's already had when he could have something fresh and new and exciting.
One of the other great things about Mary Richards, she was most fully herself with her female friends. Okay, with Phyllis Lindstrom, Rhoda Morgenstern.
What man in your life, could have been a long time ago, or someone you just met, do you wish you knew better?
Well, there was this professional dancer.
Not you.
And the cast itself benefits from a selfless star in Mary.
She would say, in a run through. You know, Jim, Alan, I think this joke is a Rhoda line. I don't think it's as good for Mary. She's giving away laughs.
As Mary explains to Barbara Walters, she had no issue playing the straight woman.
Are you naturally funny?
No, I'm really not. I have a natural love of other people's senses of humor.
The show begins effortlessly churning out iconic moments.
There was the one where Walter Cronkite shows up. That's pretty funny.
Excuse me, could you know where I could find Lou Grant?
He's right in there.
That's Walter.
Hi. Coach, you said you were good friends.
Oh, I said we were good friends. I only said that we never met.
Speaking of good friends, Rhoda and Phyllis keep the laughs coming stylish apartment in the attic of Victorian in Minneapolis, which still remains a tourist attraction.
The show where Valerie has lost her job as a window dresser, and she's in Mary's apartment day and night, night and day, 24/7. I'm just sick of it. I'm just sick of it.
Mary, we have to force her to take a good, hard look at herself. We have to shake her up. We have to slap some sense into her.
And she says, Rhoda. And then she comes over and takes and disconnects my dryer.
Rhoda!
And the winner is
Mary Tyler Moore Show.
Throughout its run, the Mary Tyler Moore Show amasses historic critical success.
The Mary Tyler Moore Show as a whole actually was one of the most awarded by the Television Academy.
And Mary Tyler Moore also has success behind the camera. The production company she started with her then husband, Grant Tinker, begins launching a string of hit shows.
They did the Bob Newhart Show.
Hello.
They did their spin-offs from the Mary Tyler Moore Show, which were Rhoda.
Do you believe this person?
Lou Grant.
I liked you better fat.
Everybody says that.
Phyllis.
It fills a void since the passing of Lars.
Hill Street Blues, Saint Elsewhere.
The MTM signature, a cat meowing in homage to the roar of the MGM lion and to Mary herself.
I think it actually really symbolizes her nicely because she was a tough broad, but she was also this amazing comedic actress and powerhouse.
But if there's one episode that showcases all of Mary Tyler Moore's gifts, it's the one titled Chuckles Bites the Dust, considered by many to be one of the greatest episodes in television history.
Something terrible has happened. Chuckles Clown is dead. It was a freak accident. He went to the parade as Peter Peanut, and a rogue elephant tried to shell him.
It was about how different people react differently to death, and some people have to laugh it off.
I can just see the insurance claim. Cause of death, a busted goop.
And Mary didn't think it was proper, you know, to do that.
It's a release, Mary. People need it to get over a tragedy. Everybody does it.
Don't.
She was very stern with everybody, making jokes about how this Chuckles the Clown had died dressed in a peanut suit.
Suppose he hadn't been dressed as a peanut. Would his death still be funny?
Could have been worse. Could have gone as Billy Bonnet and had a gorilla peeled to death.
She was actually trying so hard not to laugh all week during the shooting of Chuckles the Clown that she kind of almost bit her lip raw.
I wonder which ones are the other clowns.
I don't know, son. They're all going to jump out of a little hearse.
And then when you get to the funeral scene, his pompous minister goes into all this stupid stuff that the Chuckles had done in his life.
Billy Bonnet. My particular favorite, Aunt Yoo-Hoo.
And that's the first time she loses it and just starts bursting out laughing.
There was always some deeper meaning to whatever Chuckles did. Excuse me, young lady.
Comedy gold, because it contains this phrase, a little song, a little dance.
A little seltzer, darling.
But all good things come to an end. And after 7 seasons, the Mary Tyler Moore Show ends its run. a bittersweet moment for its star.
I was crumbling inside. I didn't want it to end. It was my family. And I thought, surely there are more stories to be done.
Their story ends with a tearful group hug and a final gaze from its trailblaze star before she turned off the light. Coming up, lights dim on the show, but not on the dark secret in Mary's life and the tragedy that mirrors her most famous film.
It's just so shocking that something like that would happen.
Stay with us.
2020 continues with Mary Tyler Moore, After All.
After 7 years of the Mary Tyler Moore Show, 5 Emmys, countless magazine covers, Mary is trying to figure out her next act. It is 1979 when she invites Barbara Walters into the home she has just built. Her 16-year marriage to Grant Tinker seems, if only on the surface, to be as solid as ever.
You never thought, hey, you know, look at all I missed out there.
No, because I get so much from Grant. I think of him primarily as my best friend, and he is also my lover. What more do I need?
Well, I'm not going to talk you out of it.
But what she's not telling Barbara is that her marriage is actually crumbling. Mary later writes of fights with Tinker, about her storming into my car in a fury, playing dangerous Russian roulette as she'd hit the accelerator and run each stop sign. Just 7 months after this interview airs, the marriage is over. Her career isn't faring much better.
So, Variety. Okay, let's give it a try.
She tries 2 new musical variety shows. Both shows are quickly canceled.
Do you feel like a flop? Do you feel like a failure? Did it hurt like hell?
Yes, it did. All of those things. Yeah, it really hurt a lot. I'm going to be very grown up, lay some of the responsibility on myself, and say, okay, look in another direction.
Always remember.
That direction turns out to be a dark one, but it leads to her much-awaited comeback.
I know I'm not perfect.
Director Robert Redford casts Mary in Ordinary People, the story of an affluent family strained by the accidental death of their prized son.
I think it is a very private matter.
Redford knew what he was doing. I mean, it's a risk in the sense that she wasn't a bankable actress. She wasn't Jane Fonda.
He claims that he used to see me walking on the beach at Malibu, where we both lived, and he used to wonder about the dark side of Mary Tyler Moore. And I guess he was right to wonder about that, because there is, in fact, a dark side.
And in that dark side is anger, tension,
rigidity, unreasonable expectations. Not bad characteristics, well-meant. People after that film would say, oh, she was such a bitch, wasn't she? And she wasn't.
I just want you to be happy.
Happy?
Yes.
Ward, you tell me the definition of happy. But first you make sure that your kids are safe, that no one's fallen off a horse or been hit by a car or drowned in that swimming pool you're so proud of.
Oh,
and then you come to me and tell me how to be happy.
The performance draws rave reviews and an Oscar nomination.
The popular Mary Tyler Moore.
But less than 4 weeks after the movie's release,
the 24-year-old son of actress Mary Tyler Moore has died of a gunshot wound to the head.
The shooting is later ruled accidental.
I mean, the whole movie is about the loss of a child, the loss of a son. It's just so shocking that something like that would happen right in the middle of her talking about this movie.
What got you through it?
I think time, just time.
Did you ever think this is insupportable?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, but I know that the only alternative is not one that I want, and the alternative is to not be here.
But Mary is checking out in other ways, turning to alcohol, a secret addiction she has been hiding even during her star turn as Mary Richards.
I think I should have talked about it more, either with a counselor or a therapist or my friends. And then I probably would not have gone through the alcoholism. I'm not sure that that's true, and I don't want to lay that off entirely on my son's death.
While dealing with her heartbreak and self-medicating with alcohol, in 1982, Mary meets a doctor caring for her mother.
I saw this tall, dark, handsome doctor, and I thought to myself, well, Mary, you bad girl, you you know what you're going to do, don't you? And I did. I knew I was going to be assertive, and I was going to make the first move.
How did you make the first move?
In parting, he said, I'm going to leave you my home phone number in case there's any kind of emergency ever.
Dr. Robert Levine is 17 years her junior. Still, Mary decides to call that next night at 3 o'clock in the morning.
I said, does acute loneliness come under the heading of emergency? He said, I can't think of a better reason to be awakened.
The two marry, and the third time is a charm as they stay together for the rest of Mary's life.
Everyone looks at Mary as being exceptionally confident and capable and able. And while she is capable, the confidence really is not there.
After years of numbing those insecurities with alcohol, in 1984, Mary finally checks herself into rehab at the Betty Ford Clinic.
Was it hard to stop?
Yes, it was. People were stunned when it came out that I went to Betty Ford, which I tried to do very quietly, very secretly, but it did come out. And in retrospect, I'm glad that it did because it was helpful to a lot of women like me, women who thought of themselves as being kind of ladylike and fairly intelligent and obviously therefore not alcoholic, because how could you be? But you can be.
Next, the famous five: Mary, Rhoda, Phyllis, Georgette, and Sue Ann Nivens, together again.
None of us has changed.
Gravity has taken over.
In a career that spanned nearly six decades, full of smiles and success, there's something else: a lifelong struggle with type 1 diabetes.
When you're a diabetic, you live with the question, sort of, if I can put it in a dramatic way, every day you wake up and you say, is this going to be the day that the kidney fails, or that this fails, or that I have a heart attack or a stroke?
Over the years, she talks about it often.
I need insulin to stay alive.
The same woman who turned the world on with her smile is losing her eyesight. Who danced with Dick Van Dyke becomes unable to walk down the street without stopping to rest.
Join us. Your help is our hope.
And now, in a very different kind of role, Mary Tyler Moore changes the world again.
We're here because of our children, our loved ones with diabetes.
She was thinking of young people who needed her support and needed the funding and research to try to change their lives.
As international chairman of the Juvenile Diabetes Research Foundation, she gives her time and her famous face to make people in power care about the issue.
And it won her the respect of the medical community and of everybody who ever saw her on that behalf.
We need to be able to tell the children that we are investing the dollars necessary.
Her heart was bigger than anyone I've ever met. She has such compassion towards people in need or animals.
These are dogs that are either abandoned or lost.
Together with her close friend Bernadette Peters, she starts Broadway Barks, a group of actors dedicated to finding homes for four-legged friends in distress.
She was someone that just couldn't let those things go by.
No wonder, then, so many tweets this week honoring Mary pour in from animal lovers, from the Humane Society to PETA. They know for her, every living creature counted. For all those good deeds and, of course, all those great performances, in 2012, the Screen Actors Guild honors her with a Lifetime Achievement Award. There to present it, who else? Dick Van Dyke.
And really, I can't think of someone in the entertainment industry more deserving of a Lifetime Achievement Award than Mary Tyler Moore.
Thank you so much.
But still to come, another showstopper.
Hello, Clubs!
In 2015, for the first time in decades, Mary and all her co-stars from Frozen Minneapolis reunite on Hot in Cleveland as guests on Betty White's show.
How comes she to be in the center every bitch?
Because I have
the smile.
You bet your beret was a big deal to have them all together. I mean, it was.
such a big deal.
That show opened up a whole new world for girls who grew up watching it, including me.
Hi, lady.
Katie Couric can't pass it up.
I am so thrilled and honored. Being with the entire cast of the Mary Tyler Moore Show was the thrill of a lifetime for me.
A group interview right on the set.
I hear it all the time about Mary. Oh, Mary inspired me to do this.
Every time anybody talks to me about it, they always say Betty inspired them, not Mary.
She, I think, was an exceedingly private person and very humble. Why did Mary Richards captivate and really capture the hearts of so many people?
I think it was because our writers wrote so honestly.
Even though she was the heart and soul of that show, she would always credit the writers or talk about the ensemble nature of the show. What is it like for you all working together after 40 years?
Heaven.
Yeah, it really is heaven, and none of us has changed.
Well, we've done the best we can. Gravity has taken over a little bit.
You could tell sitting in that room that those women truly loved each other, and it was so genuine, you can't fake that.
And it's just, you know, makes me think, what a lucky woman you are. How fabulous to be working with the people who are your very good friends.
When someone like Mary leaves us, it just really heartbreaking.
Any regrets?
I tell you, my only regret is that I didn't have more children. I lost my son 14 years ago. And I don't have and will not have grandchildren.
So how would you like to be remembered?
I would like to be remembered as somebody who made a difference in the lives of animals.
And in terms of television, movies, Broadway?
As somebody who always looked for the truth, even if it wasn't funny.
Next, a theme song for the ages from the stars who were there at the start.
Well, it's you, girl, and you should know it.
The story behind the song.
Who can take a
nothing day?
That the whole world learned and loved to sing along.
It has become one of the most beloved sitcom themes in history by Ask a Simple Question.
Who can turn the world on with her smile?
Endlessly recreated from Joan Jett. To Family Guy. For creator Sonny Curtis, a musician with a rock pedigree, the song comes surprisingly easily.
Well, it all happened in one day. Believe it or not.
Based off a 4-page description of the show, Curtis writes the song, Love is All Around, in one afternoon, rushing to CBS to play the tune for show's creator, James L. Brooks.
He said, you know, you're a little early. We're not quite to the stage of picking a theme song. And he said, but I'll listen to what you got.
And it was perfect. I mean, we didn't change a word.
It may only be 56 seconds, but even decades later, 2020 has no problem finding people who know every word to that iconic song.
Who can turn the world on with her smile?
Who can take
a nothing day
and suddenly make it all seem worthwhile?
Well, it's you, girl, and you should know it.
With each glance
and every little moment, you show it.
Love is all around.
No need to waste it.
You can have a town.
Why don't you take it?
You're gonna make it after all.
Ah, song for the ages, and one we'll probably be singing all weekend long. So what was your favorite Mary Tyler Moore scene or episode?
Let us know on Facebook or Twitter. Use the hashtag ABC2020. Thanks so much for joining us tonight as we say goodbye to an American sweetheart. I'm David Muir.
And I'm Elizabeth Vargas. From all of us here at 2020 and ABC News, have a great night and a great weekend.